So hyper-narrative aside, let's start a conversation. So first I wanted to pose each of you a question looking at the international relations for individual leader, for nation state, from international system. Now there's a concern in the United States, a worry about China's increasing assertiveness in foreign policy, and some said it's quite a proactive and even aggressive approach. And my question is now in your view, if you can tell us why that kind of worry, and is that concern well grounded?
Well, the short answer is yes, but let me say a little bit more about why. I think it might be useful to spend just a minute or two talking about where this tendency may come from. Because it's a relatively recent development in Chinese policy. I think since the starting at the end of the Cold War, China began to pursue a policy that's really captured in this famous 24-character strategy that Deng Xiaoping is supposed to have written and circulated to party members right before the collapse of the Soviet Union, a couple of years after Tiananmen, in which he advised that China should hide its capabilities and buy its time. And that generally through the 1990s and into the early part of this century, I think China followed that advice, concentrated on building up all the elements of its so-called comprehensive national powers and economic growth, military capabilities, and other instruments of power. Generally avoided confrontation, particularly with big powers, especially with the United States. And I think was content to advance incrementally, to strengthen its own position, particularly in Asia, and to the extent possible to begin to work away around the edges to undermine and weaken the position of the United States. Under Hu Jintao, there was some discussion of what had emerged by then, I think, as a central issue for Chinese strategic theorists, which was, what do we do with our obviously growing power? And what do we do about the fact that others are going to recognize us increasingly as a growing power? And Hu was a very cautious fellow, and I think he was reluctant to make major changes. You may remember for a while, a year or two, the Chinese introduced the slogan of peaceful rise, but then it was dropped because some people thought it was sounded too aggressive, rise. Other people currently in the Chinese system thought it sounded too wimpy, peaceful. So they went back around talking about peaceful development instead. For me, the big change really comes with the financial crisis, 2008-2009. I think that that event and what followed from it is really, in retrospect, going to appear as a turning point in the development of Chinese policy. And it really had the effect of strengthening both the sense of confidence and ambition on the part of Chinese leaders and Chinese strategic thinkers, the sense that China was growing faster, perhaps, than they might have originally hoped, and just as important, that the United States was in decline more rapidly than perhaps had been anticipated. So a sense of optimism and a feeling that it was time for China to step out and to assert itself more. But at the same time, also a deepening of underlying anxiety on the part of leadership about the long-term stability and durability of the regime. Tend to forget, but at least at the very early stages of the financial crisis, people in China were very worried about the implications for their growth. They were really bracing for rapid increases in unemployment, social instability as a result of drop-off in global demand. And they managed to steer around that largely because they unleashed a massive stimulus package. But I think it was kind of a near-death experience for the leadership, and it made them even more worried about the future and about the challenges of changing their economic model and going down to a slower rate. Those two concerns, I think, together tended to reinforce this inclination to be more assertive, and particularly in the so-called maritime disputes with Japan, also in the South China Sea. The ambition, on the one hand, obviously asserting China's claims, long-standing claims, to control most of the resources and territory in the South China Sea, but also because of the anxiety that they felt about their domestic situation, a recognition that some degree of tension with China's neighbors over these disputes was actually useful for purposes of mobilizing domestic political support, stirring nationalist sentiment, the regime relies on now for its strength. Those tendencies have been redoubled under Xi Jinping. So since the end of 2012 and 2013, his emergence, I think, he's a very different kind of personality than his predecessor, and it's a very different kind of leadership than the Hu Jintao's collective leadership. So I think the assertiveness is real. Your question was really, is it a cause for concern? I think the answer is yes, for many reasons, but to start with, because it increases the risk of miscalculation and conflict between China and its neighbors, and potentially between China and the United States. So that's a short answer at the end and a very long-winded preface, but I think it is important to ask how we got to exactly where we are now.
There's, I think, several areas that I'd like to, directions I'd like to go in. I'm not sure which one to start with because they're both so important, all of them. But I guess one, getting back to Trish's question, your answer about Chinese aggressiveness, can we talk a little bit maybe about the cultural roots of that? Because I think that's important. Jim Lilly, when he was still alive, helped me a bit with my dissertation several years ago, great guy. And he impressed upon me his experience living as a youth in China and how the culture was utterly different than Americans. Americans love to help the underdog. The Chinese aren't necessarily like that. And as we saw in Mike Pillsbury's book that came out last year as well, which jives very well with what Jim Lilly told me, their view of being the top dog, getting to get to that position, is a bit different from ours. We certainly make mistakes and have failings, but at least we try to be consensual in our style of leadership. It's a very different sense of leadership than the Chinese have. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Well, one thing which I think is certainly true is that China has obviously a very long history, and a long history of being a dominant power in Asia. From the Chinese perspective, certainly the perspective of the current Chinese leadership, this natural position was taken away by the intrusion of imperial powers, particularly Western powers, but also Japan, beginning in the so-called century of humiliation, the Opium Wars in the 1840s. And that really upset the natural balance and put China into a subordinate position. And so I think it's not surprising that for some people, maybe for many people, the growth of China's economy, the sense of China's increasing capabilities, summons up these memories of an earlier time when China was, in fact, the dominant player in its region. And I think that underlies some of what we see going on now. Obviously, it takes a very different form than it might have 1,000 years ago. But I do think that ambition is there, and it's not hard really to understand,
right,
especially in light of that perspective.
Exactly. We don't want to spend a lot of time talking about the Panama Papers, but since they are big in the news, and you mentioned China's leadership's sense, especially after the financial crisis, but I think it's still there, the sense of vulnerability. Panama Papers, Min Ching Pei wrote an interesting piece in Fortune, Days of Liberty. I don't know if you've read that yet or not, but it was pretty good, talking about how this impacts the Chinese leadership and how this could contribute to the centrifugal forces pulling apart the Chinese Communist Party. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure.
What do you see?
Well,
going
back to what I was saying a minute ago about Xi Jinping coming into power and sort of acceleration of some of the tendencies that were happening before, one very notable feature of his regime since he arrived in power has been this vigorous anti-corruption campaign that he launched. In a sense, it began just before he took power, the so-called Bojilai affair, which brought to light, I think, for the first time, the reality of Chinese corruption, official corruption, reaching to the very highest levels of the party and the state. That prior to that time, it had been possible to maintain the illusion that corruption was kind of a local, middle-level problem, and that the center was the force of righteousness and would come in and deal with the corrupt party leaders. Well, in fact, the corruption was all the way to the top. I think Xi Jinping recognizes that corruption is potentially the Achilles heel of the regime. It is something that could eat away at the legitimacy of the regime. And the reason for the anti-corruption campaign, aside from whatever it does to lower corruption, which it may or may not do in the long run,
is, and aside from the fact that it seems also to be directed primarily at people who are his enemies, the primary purpose is to send this public message that we are going to be righteous, the party is going to revert to its historic righteousness, and we're going to purge wrongdoers and set ourselves on the proper path. That's a very dangerous thing to have done, I think, because it's not clear where you stop or how you stop. It certainly generates a lot of animosity and fear, so there's resistance and opposition. But I think it also may raise popular expectations that somehow this problem is going to be solved, when it seems to me, given the authoritarian nature of the regime, it's never going to be solved, unless and until you have the independent judiciary and so on.
Right.
So the Panama Papers are just another reminder of the fact that very top people in the Chinese system and or their friends and relatives have been siphoning off huge amounts of money and enriching themselves and taking that money now outside the country, increasingly and stashing it in various places, including in the United States, but also in Panama. That has to be very worrisome to the regime. And in fact, I gather that they have blocked or are trying to block everything related to
Panama hats.
You can't find it on the internet. It's very scary for them.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, this is just one of a series of revelations that have been coming out for the last several years, which will continue.
Right, and one of the things about the Panama Papers as well, and we'll shift, we'll pivot, pun intended, off of that, is this is just the beginning of the revelations, apparently. This is, 5-10%, something, a very small percentage of the documents that they have been put out. So it's going to be interesting to see what comes up.
Where it leads.
Exactly. Yeah, it's almost like Edward Snowden and that.
Right.
It's going to be a drippy, leaky faucet for a long time.
Yes.
In getting back to the anti-corruption campaign in general, which, as you noted, is targeted as much at inconsolidating powers as rooting out corruption, David Shambaugh, I think it was Conby, several others in the last year or two have talked about how this could really bite into the behind, could really hurt Xi, because you have tigers, that are quite large and quite muscular and are not willing to be taken down; they're going to be fighting back. Can you speak a little bit about how successful you think he has been, or give any sense of that so far, both in tapping on corruption and also consolidating power he has, but there are still poles of power that are quite possible and dangerous to him.
Right.
How much of a danger is that to him, do you think, are those poles of power?
Well, on the question of how successful he's been thus far, he's been quite successful in taking down some very powerful people who I don't think, when he first emerged, thought that they were going to be at risk.
So he's
gone very fast and gone very high, and now has extended this campaign out to touch tens of thousands of lesser officials. So this is now, in some ways, similar to the purge, and as I said, it's not quite clear where it stops. On the question of opposition, it is interesting that when he first came to power, there were reports of troop movements and there were rumors that there might be opposition. And I don't know if any of those were really true, but it wouldn't have been surprising if there were people who were very worried, particularly after Ho Chi Minh went down,
right,
that they were going after people who were close to him. This is one of those things that you don't know until you find out if there is really strong opposition. I think the likelihood of coup or his forcible removal from office is pretty small. However, he might face difficulties of a more conventional sort politically if he's seen to stumble, if his policies are seen to fail. For example, if the economy continues to slow down, he's going to be vulnerable, in part because a lot of people don't like him and are scared of him. One other comment I'd make, though, it's really looking forward. Chinese leadership, at least as things work now, serves at the top levels for 2 5-year terms. It served for 10 years and then they're supposed to go. And for a while, at least, it looked like the Chinese Communist Party had solved this problem of a peaceful transition of power in an authoritarian regime. They had a mechanism for vetting and selecting. And there are also unwritten rules of political competition, including that you don't go after
the guys who you replace or their
right.
families. And he's now come very close to, if not actually having broken those rules.
Exactly.
So what that suggests is the next power struggle could be a duel to the death. And I think that could be the moment at which the system could become
the crest to start to
right.
Yeah.
Right. And that's, we've still got another 5 years or so to go. Some people are saying Xi Jinping is trying to set the stage to break this precedent, to serve another term. Mm-hmm. Presumably, that might be, if it's true, because he's riding the tiger. He doesn't want to get off.
Right.
But I think he may, in the long run, it may turn out that he's done things to destabilize the system.
Yeah.
Without intending to.
Right. Right. You talked about success or lack of success of various policies of his. Let's talk about Taiwan briefly, because we had an election that
right.
that recently happened. Beijing's policy toward Taiwan in the last decade or so can be seen as very successful. What do you see happening in the change of dynamics now? The election of a new candidate who
right.
are not so warm
yes.
toward Beijing.
Well, one thing to note is that from 1996, but particularly 2000 and 2004, when the DPP, the opposition to the Kuomintang party, won presidential elections, Chinese were very concerned, made threatening gestures and so on, and they were tremendously relieved when the Kuomintang was able
yeah.
to win the presidential election in 2008. And in fact, it's just a hypothesis, but perhaps one reason why the Chinese, if they were looking for external tensions, why they chose the South China Sea, East China Sea, is because the Taiwan problem had, at least for the moment, receded into the background. Taiwan traditionally has been the issue that they've
yeah.
used to mobilize national sentiment and popular support. So for the last 8 years, there's been quiet on that front. And I think the Chinese have been pursuing their preferred strategy towards Taiwan, which is to try to absorb and encircle and entice Taiwan to eventually accept Beijing's terms for some kind of unification. But that strategy was never going to work because Taiwan is a democracy and most people on Taiwan don't want to be reunified with mainland. And now, of course, a DPP candidate has been elected president. For the moment, at least, things are quiet on that front. But that's something to watch. I think it's going to change the Beijing regime. I think feels that it eventually has to solve this problem, can't afford to allow itself to be humiliated by a Taiwan that's openly in opposition or moving towards independence, which I don't think is very likely. So I think is an area where we're likely to see increasing tension. For the moment, at least, the regime seems to have learned some lessons from the past where ratcheting up tension actually was counterproductive. They haven't done that. But I don't expect that's going to persist for the next 4 years or 8 years if the DPP stays in power.
Yeah. It's been interesting to me, just as a brief aside, when I first started studying Chinese history under John Wilkins, looking at the just visceral hatred between the Kuomintang and the Chinese Communist Party, and how now they have become partners, really. It's just interesting how history has these turnarounds.
Yes, and of course that was the basis for the compromises that allowed formal recognition by the United States of the mainland government. The I suppose it wasn't a fiction, but the convenient fact that at least the KMT and the CCP agreed to one shot.
Right.
But that's not going to be enough to hold things together.
Right. Well, you mentioned the South China Sea and the East China Sea, so that's a good idea for us to, that's a great segue for us to move into that. Because you're right, that is the big concern, the biggest concern today, and in those two areas, the biggest potential flashpoints. So one of the things that you talk about in your book is the fact that the fact that we need to set firm, we need to have a clearly defined position for the Chinese. Strategic ambiguity is not always a good thing. And historically, when you look at when we have had successful Chinese Sino-American relations, there's been times when we have been very clear about what our interests were, what we were willing to defend, and the Chinese knew exactly where we stood, and when they respected our resolve and our strength. We seem to be at a point today where that's not so much the case. Chinese officials behind the scenes have many times spoken unofficially to their American interlocutors, saying, we see a window of opportunity before the current administration leaves office to consolidate strategic gains and maybe even to extend. Of course, now we've seen the latest news about Scarborough Shoals, and there's just always something more happening. What do you see happening over the next 9 months? Is there a danger? How obvious is the danger? The phrase, how great is the danger that that there actually will be some sort of a, that we'll have a serious conflict out there?
I don't think the probability is that high, but then again, I don't think the problem is going away either. The Chinese have pushed forward. The two situations are somewhat different, and you mentioned the clarity or lack of clarity of the American position. In the case of Japan, Senkaku's, after some hesitation, the administration decided that it was necessary to make absolutely clear that although the U.S. doesn't take a position on the eventual disposition of those territories, that it regards them as being under the administrative control of Japan, which means that they're covered under the Mutual Security Pact. In other words, the United States would go to war if Japan were attacked on the Senkakus. And the president himself made statements to that effect. And I think that was very important and necessary because the Chinese were pushing and pushing to see if there was some kind of seam between the U.S. and Japan. In the South China Sea, the situation is more complicated for various reasons. There's a certain lack of clarity about exactly what our treaty with the Philippines covers, for example. Of course, we don't have any treaty with Vietnam. So there's more room for mischief there. What I would expect to see happen over the next 9 months is a continuation of what we've seen. The Chinese are building these so-called artificial islands. Having said they wouldn't militarize them, they're putting radars and weapons and combat aircraft there. So if that's not militarization, I don't know what is. And I think they're going to continue with that. I don't see any likelihood that they would stop. And I don't think there's very much that we can do to stop them. One factor which perhaps limits the likelihood of confrontation is that the administration seems to be very concerned about pushing too hard. I happen to think that that's a mistake, and it will allow the Chinese to go further than they might otherwise. But I don't see this as leading to imminent conflict. But the problem, the larger problem of China trying to assert effective control over waters and airspace of much of the South China Sea is not going to go away. These are not new claims. They go back to the 1940s. The difference is that China now feels that it has the opportunity and has the capabilities to actually try to enforce those claims.
So let's move forward to the next presidency, whomever it is. How do you approach something like this? That's a pretty difficult problem. Whoever it is, from whichever party, you take office in January 2017, you have the status quo that has shifted. What do you do about it?
Well, one thing to note is whoever it is likely to face some kind of test fairly early on, and particularly in this part of the world, it is a pattern. In 2001, shortly after George W. Bush came into office, there was a so-called EP3 incident. Shortly after President Obama was elected, there was another incident involving a U.S. survey ship in the South China Sea. So one thing I would expect is that there will be something similar. The Chinese want to see how much resolve is there. This is a long-term problem. I think the current administration has tried to do some of the right things to deal with it, but it hasn't always fallen through as fully as it might. Basically, whoever it is, if they want to deal with this problem, of course, if it's a candidate who thinks that our alliances are a big waste of time and money and that we should get out, then we don't have to deal with it. But assuming that such a person is not elected, then the question is going to be how to do many of the things that we're already starting to do, how to further strengthen our alliances, how to encourage cooperation, not only between us and our allies, but among other countries in the region, like Australia, Japan, India, how to strengthen the capacity of local countries to defend their own waters and airspace, and how over the long term to put ourselves in a position where we can simply refuse to acknowledge these claims that China is making. This is, in part, a game of chicken. I think the Chinese have been creating situations that appear to carry risk and do carry some risk in the hopes that others, the United States and other countries in the region, would back away.
I think we have to be willing to take a certain amount of risk and to say, for example, if China were to declare an air defense identification zone over the South China Sea and insist that all aircraft request their permission or inform Chinese authorities before they transit it, if they were to do that, we would have to be willing to simply say we don't acknowledge this and we're going to continue to operate as normal. Now, that does involve some risk. My own assessment is the Chinese would not do things that could bring them directly into conflict with us. But we have to have a certain amount of nerve and resolve in order to test that proposition. Otherwise, we're just going to be backing away and backing away, and then they can effectively assert control over this whole domain.
Right, right. And you raise an important point about how China would most likely, if we showed nerve and resolve, China, the last thing they want is a war with the United States. And I think it's important to note that one of the reasons why they're behaving this way is because they feel pretty certain that we're going to keep backing away. Maybe we could talk about a bit, tying back into CCP legitimacy and concern for their hold on power, that I think the CCP knows that if there was an actual conflict, it could threaten their hold on power. There's a lot of negative implications too, but their primary concern is to maintain the monopoly of power.
Right.
So,
yes, I agree with that. I think the way to understand everything that the leadership does in terms of both foreign and domestic policy is to start with the supposition that it's intended in some way, whether it does or not, it's intended to bolster the CCP's monopoly on political power. That's really job one. I guess the one exception to that is corruption, again, having your hand in the till. If you really want to maintain the CCP's legitimacy, you wouldn't do that, but the temptation is too great for most mere mortals. So they want to maintain legitimacy, and this has been a task which they've tried to address, probably tried to address over the last 25 years or so through stimulating economic growth, improving people's standard of living, and also by stimulating a certain kind of nationalism after Tiananmen, after 1989, when the party recognized that traditional communist ideology no longer had much appeal, they began very deliberately and self-consciously to create a system of so-called patriotic education, which now exists at all levels in the Chinese educational system and inculcates a certain view of Chinese history, which I summarized a minute ago.
And a very negative view of China's American relations.
Yes, and China's relations with Japan, of course, as well, with Britain, too.
Yeah.
The most important aspect of that ideology, if you can call it that, that system of thought, is that it casts the CCP as the superhero that rescues China from humiliation, and it is necessary going forward to preserve China's identity and autonomy and so on.
Right.
So it's an ideology that serves the purposes of the party. Many people have pointed out, I think it's true, that if economic growth is going to slow, as it appears that it's going to, the other part of the legitimacy package is going to have to grow and to get stronger. So nationalism is going to become more important rather than less, especially if China is facing difficult economic times. And what better way to convey those sentiments or to arouse those feelings than to say we are trying to take back what is rightfully ours, what was taken from us by Japan, by the United States, by other countries in the region.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I think we're going to see more of this pressure on the maritime disputes. I think the leadership believes, the Chinese leadership believes, that they can kind of turn up the heat on this and turn it down. They've got a couple of burners. And so far that's been true. They've been able to control those confrontations with outside players, and there have been times, I think, when they were a little worried about people getting overexcited in China itself. There were riots in 2012, the anti-Japanese riots that had to do with the Senkakus. So I think the leadership does recognize that although they've summoned up and encouraged this force, they don't entirely control it, and it can be dangerous to them.
Yeah.
So they have to balance between those two. But it seems to me now to be an integral part of the current regime's package of policies. got domestic policies, they've got external policies, and distance is right at the core, and those are just very closely linked to these confrontations, which they hope they can control with other parties.
Yeah. Well, getting to your point about the messaging, the internal domestic messaging, as well as messaging the outside world, that China, the superhero Chinese, trying to right the wrongs of the past. I remember, this is a personal anecdote, when I was living in Shanghai, part of what I did in order to pay as both working but also doing PhD studies. And so I did TV acting and things. One of the things, one of the job offers I got was to be the white guy that gets beat up by the righteous Chinese because I was the evil imperialist.
Could have made a career out of
it. Yeah, I could have. It didn't pay very much. In addition to getting beat up and being portrayed as an evil guy. So I didn't do it. But it was interesting how, to me, to see then, and it goes along with what you're saying, of how important that has been, how deeply embedded that is in the Chinese psyche, not just obviously in the government, but on the part of the people. Largely, as you say, through the education system, which is something I think Mike did a good job in his book of tracing out how, from the elementary school on up, they learn this version of history that demonizes us. Everybody since President Tyler apparently had an evil plan to subjugate China. And when you grow up learning nothing but that, you're going to have a very negative attitude toward the United States, which I think goes a long way to explaining why we have Pew Foundation recently had a poll number that showed both American populace and the Chinese populace dislike each other and distrust each other. And obviously, the Chinese education system is one part of the reason why that's true in the Chinese side of the equation.
Right. I haven't seen the most recent polls, but what I can remember seeing a year or so ago was on the U.S. side, it's a little bit more nuanced. People didn't express animosity towards China or towards Chinese people. They had mistrust of the Chinese regime,
yes,
and also concerns about the Chinese economic policies and the growth of Chinese military power, all of which I think are well-founded. But the sentiment on the Chinese side is, doesn't have to doubt that it's real, that people have those feelings, but it's also clear that they have been encouraged and fueled by what the machine has been doing for its own reason.
Yeah, precisely. the book, as Patricia said, came out in 2011, and therefore by necessity is a bit dated in some areas, but most of it, obviously, is the vast majority, so highly relevant, partly because the policy on the American side has, since 2011, is still being run by the Obama administration. Patricia mentioned the alliance system that we have and China's lack thereof. And you mentioned the future present. Hopefully we'll have somebody who actually sees value in it. Can you talk a bit about how that obviously is an advantage for us and how that can help us? Not so much, with security also, but I'm thinking primarily of South China Sea as a rule of law issue more than a potential military flashpoint, although that's clearly danger.
Right.
Rule of law and us establishing that, and therefore messaging. So I'd like us to move in the direction also of information warfare, political warfare. The Chinese have a long history of strategic thinking. They're steeped in this. Americans aren't so good at it. So can we talk a bit about that and about how they try to shape perceptions in maritime conflicts in the South China Sea? The things like having Chinese Coast Guard ships that are twice the size of our Navy cutters, but yet it's the powerful American Navy is the message, when these, and the poor Chinese Coast Guard is trying to fend off the powerful American Navy. So,
Well, you raise a number of very interesting points. Let me just try to touch on a couple of them. First, on the issue of our alliances and our quasi-alliance relationships, because one of the things that's happened over the last 20 years is that we've gotten closer to several countries that share with us a concern about the implication of Chinese growing power, even if we don't extend security guarantees to them. So Singapore is an example. India is an example. But the alliances are really critical and to our ability to maintain our presence there. And also, you mentioned rule of law and freedom of the seas. This is something in which all, not only countries in Asia, but in Europe and elsewhere, have a strong interest in this. And in fact, you're seeing some of this expressed on the part of some European governments who otherwise might feel that they were somewhat detached from what's happening in Asia. In fact, they see that they have strategic as well as economic interests in the region. And there's, I think, a growing sense that China, Russia too, to a degree, is involved in an effort to weaken and undermine some parts of the liberal international order. And we are either going to hang together in opposing that or hang separately by not. And this is freedom of the seas and rule of law is the leading indicator, I think, of the ability of, for lack of a better term, Western, and I include the Asian democracies as well, nations to defend a system which has worked well for everybody
right.
for the last, more than the last half century. On the question of alliances, yes, China doesn't have allies or North Korea. They have North Korea, which is maybe worse.
Like they chain
of
the dog.
But one thing that's interesting we haven't touched on, and I think we haven't paid enough attention to it in this country because we tend to look at China and at Asia across the Pacific, so we look at the maritime domain. But China is doing a lot on the interior frontier.
Precisely.
The so-called One Belt, One Road,
yeah.
New Silk Road, very ambitious investment, infrastructure development projects, which have an economic dimension but clearly are part of a larger strategy, which is intended to reduce China's vulnerability to maritime interdiction, but also to link other countries around China economically and politically and logistically to China. They're trying to build a new order within the global order on the eastern half of the Eurasian landmass.
Yep.
I think we're kind of asleep at the switch on this, or to the extent we pay attention to it, it's the AIIB, or there's some passing issue in treating it almost as a tactical problem. But from a Chinese perspective, this is a huge deal. And for Xi Jinping, I think it's his signature initiative.
Yeah.
So I think we have to pay attention to that and try to understand it more than we have. So that's briefly on Chinese alliances. But then remind me the last issue.
You're right. I threw a bunch at you. Let's see. We talked about rule of law.
Yes.
I thank you for bringing up One Belt, One Road. I wanted to do that. Because one of the speakers that I hosted here, I think about a month ago, was Evan Ellis
yes.
from the U.S. Army War College. He was excellent. He talked about both Russia and China's strategic presence in Latin America. Russia's, of course, more overtly military, but China has been trying, especially with the deal that has now no longer probably going to go through in many aspects with Argentina because of the chain of government down there. But nevertheless, they're trying to have a presence in our backyard.
Right. You mentioned information warfare.
Yes.
I think that was.
Yes.
Which is extremely important, I think, and really it's a part of everything the Chinese leadership tries to do, messaging, shaping the perception, shaping the understanding that others have of certain issues, framing the problems.
They devote billions of dollars.
It's a major part of their military apparatus and also their diplomatic machinery. They have a very long tradition of it. In varying ways, but political warfare, basically.
Yeah.
And that's central to what they do. Part of it is, a significant part of it has been directed at us, at the United States. And I think for the most part, until fairly recently, the message, the purpose, was to persuade people in this country that really China couldn't conceivably be a threat.
Right.
That there are many economic opportunities, and one doesn't want to lose those. The so-called China threat theory, which is the way they frame it, is a myth. Assertiveness is not really assertiveness, but it's reaction to provocations by others. And they've been fairly successful in pushing out those lines, and people pick them up and repeat them for
yep.
various reasons.
Maybe even the name of the Confucius Institute
yes.
is supposed to give a mental image of a nice, kindly old gentleman.
Right, right. And of course, it's actually an instrument of,
right.
Of the party. It's controlled by the party. So this is a major concern. I think in some ways Chinese leadership may be somewhat less concerned about lulling us into complacency than they used to be. They may feel more confident. And there may be another message which is beginning to emerge, which is not that we're weak and benign, but that we're so strong that you don't want to stand in our way. And that is, I
think, that's also something we've seen since
yes.
financial crisis.
Yes, I think so. And for one concrete manifestation of that is the fact that whereas previously, for the most part, the Chinese were quite cautious about advertising their military capabilities, and downplaying them. Now I think they're advertising them and actually exaggerating them in certain respects. I think you saw the military parade coincided with the anniversary of the end of the Second World War. The U.S. military is particularly concerned about a particular missile, the F-21, which is thought to be intended to attack U.S. aircraft carriers. Long parade that included many of these missiles, helpfully numbered DF-21, in case you missed it.
In case we were too thick to get the message.
Right. So I think there's now another message which is coming out, which is troubling because I think there's some people who are a little too inclined to believe it.
Right.
And then begin to argue that we can't maintain our presence, we shouldn't even contemplate going to war over a bunch of rocks, which really means defending our allies and defending freedom of navigation. So we're in for a different kind of contest, I think, in the next decade or so. It's going to have more of that coloration to it.
Yeah. you mentioned One Belt, One Road and the New Silk Road. And given China's economic slowdown, I wanted to ask you what your take is on how that would affect China's investments and outreach and extension of its not just its Chinese state-owned businesses, but also tentacles of Chinese power, security services, everything else. I would imagine, initial take is that we'll probably see a redoubling of effort in many of these areas because there'll be that's now a slowdown at home as an added rationale for Chinese companies seeking business abroad.
Right.
What's your take on that?
Well, it seems that that's probably one motivation, one part of what they're trying to do. If One Belt, One Road involves a lot of infrastructure. One of the things that people have pointed out about Chinese economic development at home is that there's been excessive investment in infrastructure and basic industries and so on. And they haven't been able to slow it down and to shift over to a more consumption-driven growth model. Well, possibly this is one way of dealing with some of that, basically exporting it. You have to fund it, so they're maybe using some of their funds, they may be trying to get others to fund it as well. So it may have an economic dimension to it, but as I said, I think at bottom it's a strategic gambit, and it's intended to achieve these larger strategic goals. But it is an interesting question about how China's policies will be affected if they now enter into a protracted period of slow growth. We've seen, at least reported in the official figures, some reduction in the rate of increase in the defense spending, which we haven't seen for a while. And yet, the takeaway there is, I think they're still committed to maintaining and expanding the military. Probably see increases in resources devoted to domestic security if they're concerned about internal stability. And reportedly, as of a couple of years ago, they were paying more for the so-called People's Armed Police, which is really a second army that has the mission of maintaining domestic control, than they were for the PLA, the People's Liberation Army. Also, they're sitting on a lot of capital, and they're looking for places to invest it. Some of that is coming here, and of course it's welcome in one sense, but it may also cause issues if it involves attempts to buy American companies that are at the leading edge of different technologies. We've seen that just in the last few weeks.
Or even just hotels. We saw that as a
cause
for concern in the last month.
At least the president couldn't stay there.
Right.
And movie theaters, I don't know if that's really a threat to our society, or maybe it is, but it probably was before the Chinese bought the movie theaters. But so this capital is looking for some place to go, and some of this infrastructure development also may be a way of directing excess capital towards what are hoped to be thought to be productive investment.
Yeah. Well, speaking strategically, I want to move a little bit over because I've got a soft spot in my heart for Britain, spending as much time there as I did doing two graduate degrees there, and having friends that are in the Lords and are well connected with Prime Minister David Cameron. So I want to talk a bit about in Europe in general, but Britain as the point of contact. Recently, Xi Jinping, as you know, about a year ago now, I guess, went there, maybe it was just this last autumn, and David Cameron rolled out the red carpet, as did the Chancellor of the Exchequer, and it sounded pretty much like, China had displaced the United States as their special relationship.
Right.
Quite a few Brits, strategic thinkers over there, wrote that this was a mistake, So not, again, Britain as the touchstone, but Europe in general. What do you see happening with China's strategic goals in Europe? Clearly they want to try to separate the U.S. from its traditional allies.
Right. I think that's at root, strategically, that's what they would like to see happen. There was some talk of that back at the time of the Iraq War, when there was so much tension between the United States and its European allies, and some people in China wanted to push the Europeans to drop the EU arms embargo, and there was some discussion of the kind of Eurasian axis that would bring Western Europe together with Eastern China. And that's back in a way, but it has a more concrete form now because China has so much capital and Europe is in such bad trouble economically, so many places in Europe. Debt, slow growth, tremendous needs for investment, infrastructure, and it's not just countries like Greece or the newer democratic countries in Central and Eastern Europe, but the older West European powers, including Britain, including France. So the Chinese see opportunity there, and they've at least suggested that they might be willing to invest heavily in several of these countries. I don't know that they've actually done all that much yet. There's a certain amount of dangling of...
And I think people forget every time the Chinese announce, historically have announced big deals, that something like 80% of those never come to fruition. So,
well, there are a lot of big numbers that are thrown around, but it is important to see what actually comes of it. I think it's unfortunate that the way in which the British government pursued this, I think, was not wise, partly for... a very obvious reason, which is the Chinese don't respect people that they think are weak. So, and they don't really think that Europe matters much, but if anybody matters in Europe, it's France, Britain, and Germany. So they have a certain residual respect for those countries. They think the others are weak. They don't take the EU particularly seriously. And I think they would like to further weaken and divide and conquer, and if they can make the British appear to be doing their bidding in return for investment, they may hope to encourage other European countries to behave in the same way. I don't think it's going to do the British much good in the long run. I don't think there's going to be as much money there as they would like for there to be, and I think they need to be cautious, just as we do, about becoming too entangled in allowing the Chinese to invest freely in every sector of their of their economy. But it's a great temptation now for people in Europe in particular. From a Chinese perspective, Europe is one of the endpoints of the One Belt, One Road project, of course. So they are talking about building railway lines that go all the way into Western Europe that will allow movement of freight at high speed across the Asian landmass. And they seem to be quite serious about it, talking about buying ports and investing in transportation lines and so on. So Europe has now taken on a new significance, I think, for China as a terminus of
Right. You mentioned that we seem to be asleep at the switch in terms of the strategic plan behind One Belt, One Road and some of the other things. Otto von Bismarck isn't the one who said this, but he is attributed to him. It actually came from a Portuguese. It was originally attributed several decades before to a Portuguese diplomat, whose name I've now forgotten. But the old adage that there's a special province for drug schools in the United States. At times, it seems like when you look at a challenge from a country like China, who's steeped in strategic thinking, who follow a strategic plan with discipline, and those of us in the United States who are not so good at that, it seems like you have to depend on Otto von Bismarck's saying to be true for us to actually turn it okay. Can you speak to, there seems to have been signs of life occasionally with our policymaking community. One good sign I thought was John Kerry a few months ago going to Central Asia. We hadn't paid much attention then, in my view. Do you see any other signs of life, any hopeful signs within the U.S. foreign and national security community?
Well, no, I do think we're actually better than we make ourselves out to be. And maybe it's convenient if people don't think we're as good, although I think the Chinese think we're better than we are. They think everything we do is part of a grand scheme, and clearly it's not.
I think we're, as a country, we're best actually at sustaining a path once we've chosen. At least that's the lesson for me of the Cold War. A lot of people thought in the late 1940s the United States was going to go back to isolationism,
right?
And that hasn't happened, although the sentiments now are being expressed more powerfully and more openly at any time since the end of the Cold War. But we've been pretty good at staying the course. I think the challenge is when we face a significant change and we have to adjust and reach some kind of consensus about how we're going to cope with it. And that's the situation I see now. I think we are not doing enough to respond to Chinese initiatives and the growth of Chinese power. And I worry that it's going to take some kind of crisis to snap us into focus. And historically, that has tended to be the case for the United States.
Right.
We have not fully acknowledged, I think, that China is a strategic challenge. There are many complicated reasons why that's so, and some of them are strong arguments. It's a very different kind of situation than the one we faced with the Soviet Union and the Cold War, largely because of the economic relationship. But nevertheless, it is a significant strategic challenge. And I don't think we have fully woken up to it. I was looking back at the book, actually, in anticipation of coming here and kind of thinking to myself, well, okay, what did I get right and what did I get wrong and what's changed and how has it changed? And I realized in one sense, the basic argument of the book is, I think, less controversial than it might have been 5 or 6 years ago,
yeah.
The idea that we're headed into an intensifying rivalry.
When
with
you
China.
Have people like Ashley Tellis and David Shambaugh sounding the alarm now, right? Yeah.
Well, Ashley was someone who was on that, I think, well, quite
a
while ago.
Shambaugh surprised everyone, though.
Well, with his, yeah, his views on the Communist Party, I think, have changed, or his views of where China's going have changed.
Right.
But yeah, I think there's been a shift in the kind of center of gravity of that discussion. Unfortunately, I don't think we've fully taken on board the consequences or implications of that. So people will now say, yes, okay, we are involved in a contest for supremacy. I don't really like that term, but maybe that's, okay, maybe that's what we're involved in, but we don't really have to do anything differently than what we're doing already because everything is for the best in this best of all possible worlds and our policies are just fine. I was guardedly optimistic that when the current administration started talking about so-called pivot or rebalance, that it was a sign of really significant change, and it has involved some change, but I think we haven't gone as far as we need to go. My view now is that two things that could result in a major recalibration. One is some kind of crisis, which I obviously hope we don't have to experience. And the other is potentially a presidential election, because when a new person comes into office, it's an opportunity to re-examine existing policies and to consider the changes that might need to be made. So I'm guardedly optimistic that whoever it is, when they come in January 2017, will be willing and be inclined to take a deep look at all the various things that we're doing. And rethink some of the policies that we're currently pursuing in Asia and towards China specifically. But I don't know what odds I would want to place on that. We continue to be preoccupied with other pressing problems in other parts of the world. We continue to have these enduring disagreements about fiscal policy, which are a major constraint on our ability to respond to what China's doing in the military domain, and the sharp political divisions, which make it very difficult to get agreement on just about anything. So I have no doubt in the long run that we have the capacity and the resources and the allies that we need to maintain a stable and favorable balance in Asia, even if China gets stronger. Moreover, I think the Chinese have real and deeper problems even than ours,
right.
Which they're not going to be able to resolve short of some really fundamental change in the character of their political system. So I'm pretty optimistic about the long run, but I'm worried about the short to medium term. Possibility that we may face a more aggressive China at a time when we're really not very well prepared.
Right. So, window of opportunity, in other words, for the
yes.
Chinese.
Yes, potentially.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think we'll open up to your question to leave some time.
That's
so, please state your name and affiliation.
Yes, I'm Russell King, a retired federal employee. I just have a question about Chinese political leaders as they try to manipulate us, and as applies to ancient Chinese philosophy, including concepts like Wu Wei or Chan, which is Chinese for Zen, 36 strategies of ancient China, or Wei Qi, which is Game of Go. Now, you mentioned the process of encirclement with Taiwan. Well, Wei Qi is a classic game that involves encirclement and non-encirclement. And also, I think that 36 strategies, sometimes the Chinese might use them in combination, considering us analogous to a superior power in the Warring States period, because there are strategies that apply to superior, a superior enemy, enemy of the same power, and inferior enemy. Can you tell us, is there anything about the philosophy of ancient China that they use in the strategies against us? Should we be conformed? Should we be like Sun Tzu, conforming to a steam bed? You know, if we look at them the way they're doing, it's like water conforming to steam bed.
Well, so, I don't want to put myself forward as an authority on ancient Chinese philosophy or not. However, I do think we have to take seriously a civilization that has persisted over thousands of years and has a long tradition of thinking about politics and strategy in ways that are somewhat different than those that have emerged in the West. And you mentioned some of them, an emphasis on winning without fighting. That's sometimes highest manifestation of the art of the general, is to be able to achieve your objectives without using force. I think current Chinese leaders think in those terms. They're not unique in that way, but I think they are informed by this older tradition of thought, and we need to take it seriously. The other thing that, of course, Sun Tzu says in particular, but comes out in some of the other ancient Chinese writings, is an emphasis on deception, what we call political warfare. That's not something which is foreign to the current Chinese leadership, or it's a part of this longer tradition of Chinese thinking about strategy. So there's no magic arts. They haven't figured out some way of defying the laws of gravity doing things that we can't understand, but I do think they approach strategic competition with a different mindset than we do. And part of it, I think, is recognition that not every situation is a problem that can be solved or will be solved. I think we tend to approach our interactions with other countries, including China, as a series of discrete problems, which if we can only sit down and talk about it and find the right formula, we can resolve, rather than seeing them as part of a larger, longer-term positional struggle, where the object is to constrain and confine the opponent and to expand your own freedom of action. So.
Hi, Professor Friedberg. Thank you so much for sharing your insightful thought today with us. I'm Gloria from Georgetown University. My question is about nationalism. You've mentioned a little. Yesterday at an event at the United States Institute of Peace, Professor Jessica Weiss mentioned that during President Xi's presidency, we've seen an increase in top-down nationalism, but a very obvious decrease in the tolerance of grassroots nationalism. Well, we know that on the one hand, using nationalism is a good way of diverting public attention of Chinese domestic issues, but it can also backfire the government. So I'm wondering whether you could explain more on how the current regime is handling this increase in sentiment of nationalism.
Well, I think they're largely responsible for and popular media, the press, the coverage of the maritime disputes, the way that those are portrayed, a lot of discussion of military capabilities and so on. And then the references to history, and particularly the discussion of Japan, history and so on, Japan's behavior during the 30s and the Second War. So the regime uses that for reasons that you indicated and I discussed. It's not new. That's something that Chinese leadership has been doing for some time. But I do think that this regime, this leader, seems to be particularly adept at and comfortable with this kind of language and these kinds of symbolism, this kind of symbolism in discussion China Dream is. So it's very much a part of his program. We haven't seen, to my knowledge, there have not been any episodes thus far similar to the one that I mentioned in 2012, where, or as happened in 2005, where there were actual demonstrations that turned into riots, and where the authorities were clearly quite concerned about losing control and stepped in and shut things down. And that's one of the things that's emerged from some studies, including by Professor Weiss, is how the regime has sought to at times turn up and at other times turn down these sentiments, up to and including something which I had never heard of before. I think it was in 2012. I don't remember the city, where the authorities, once they had decided that things had gotten out of hand, they transmitted a message that was sent to every single cell phone in the city saying, essentially, enough's enough, stay home. This is a thank you for your patriotism, but we're not going to have any more of this. So they have the capacity, or they demonstrate the capacity thus far, to turn it up and turn it down. Mm-hmm. What people say, and I think historically there's some reason to think that the regime is sensitive to this, is that Chinese revolution, going back to the early part of the 20th century and previous upheavals, often began with protests against foreigners that then became protests against the current regime, sometimes starting with the accusation that the regime was not being tough enough and strong enough in defending China. So there is a potential danger there, but this leadership seems, in addition to its willingness to use nationalism, it's obviously tightened up the control of society to a degree even beyond what we saw under Hu Jintao and his predecessors. So control of the internet is up, pressure on any kind of dissidents or expressions of political discontent or dissent are greater than they've ever been. Pressure on non-governmental organizations, which the regime sees as
trying to undermine human rights,
and bringing people out on television.
Yeah.
One very interesting document is Document 9, which was circulated in 2013. Has this kind of sinister Orwellian sound to it, and the content is matches. But it's very revealing, because what it shows is that the leadership has perfectly good understanding of liberal democracy, civil society, rule of law, but they clearly regard all of those things as threats to the control of the Communist Party and see them as dangerous currents of thought which have to be suppressed.
No, not really. I mean, except for the fact that you said about they see all those things as negatives. It's been interesting to me how popular House of Cards has been over there.
I gather that, yes.
And, I mean, for obvious reasons, the Chinese government has really pushed it.
Yes, exactly.
Look at what these guys are like. We always knew it. We told you. These guys are bastards. And they don't seem to realize that, first of all, it's fiction, hopefully. And secondly, that we live in a society in the United States where the government allows that to be put out. It seems quite an obvious point, but something that the Chinese government seems to have missed. If a Chinese filmmaker did something like that in China, how successful do you think he'd be at getting CCTV broadcast?
Right. Portraying the leadership in that way.
Exactly.
Right. Right. And yet it would probably be closer to the truth.
Right, right.
We'll take two more questions. One at the back and one
here. My name is Kevin. I graduated from IBP last year. I was also a half hour late to this, so if you've already answered my question, just feel free to skip me and move on. 3 months ago, I read an interesting article in The Economist. They made the claim that the island disputes are less about natural resources and more about, and I'm not a naval expert, but apparently the underwater topography of the South China Sea is such that if China was able to lay claim and actually control the islands that it wants, it becomes much easier for them to deploy and operate its underwater fleet. They have one of the largest submarine fleets in the world, which in turn for the U.S. makes it much harder to monitor once they moved out of the continent, the shallow sea and continental shelf, and are now into the ocean. I'm just wondering, do you know, is there any credence to that claim?
I believe there is something to that. And it's a complicated subject, but my understanding is that it's more difficult to locate and track submarines in shallow water than deep. And the Chinese are concerned that the United States and other countries, Japan and others, in the event of a crisis or conflict, could interdict their submarines, particularly their growing fleet of nuclear ballistic missile submarines, as they tried to move out into open ocean, which they would have to do given the ranges of current missiles in order to be able to strike the United States. And that having control of some of the area of the South China Sea would better enable them to do that. I don't think that's all there is to it. I think there's sort of layers of motivation, but I also don't think the natural resources are the only part of this. Strategic motivation is obviously significant. And so too is this symbolism and sovereignty. And if it were just about natural resources, it would be possible to solve it by saying we're going to have joint development, divide this, and you can have 3/4 and not 1/4. But you can't divide sovereignty. And you also can't have it both ways on a strategic front. So I think for various reasons, they'd like to be able to control these waters.
Last question, really fast.
Well, I have no question. It's 2 hours.
Your name?
It's a tie. Retired from the Library of Congress. Incidentally, I was head of the Yes Oriental Library and East Asian Collection at Princeton for 2 years. The question has 2 parts. First part is bibliographical. Second part is political. It's about your book. I haven't had a chance to examine the Chinese translation of your book, but I'm interested in knowing who and where your book was translated into Chinese. That's one that's bibliographical. The reason I'm asking the question is that I'm very interested. I'm a former student over here, for five years, and I specialize in checking translations of Chinese intelligence books about Chinese intelligence or espionage, or books about intelligence and espionage translated into Chinese. And I have a good friend of mine who has a very, very interesting book, which is Keith Milton. I'm sure you know the name. And in the book, 2 parts were left out when they translated it. First, anything that is bad about China. Larry Wu Daijin, who was the mole at the CIA, that part was all cut out. Instead, they put something else in there. But I'm talking about translation. Second part, the head of the security, Kang Shen, that part was cut out. And I'm interested in knowing whether you have the chance to examine whether they excerpt any part of your book. So that's bibliographical.
Okay.
Second part of it is political. Did they like your book? After publication of the book, were you invited back there? I think before. I understand that some professors, some books, that after publication, the authors were not allowed back. And you know, you don't have to name the name, but I'm sure you know. Recently, there's one in Washington, D.C., you know that. You mentioned
right,
the name.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, Mike Pillsbury has been one who's had many, many invitations over there, and suddenly they dried up for a while after.
No, Mike is a good friend of mine, but he's still welcome there. But another person, I don't want to give him the name.
We have to let him answer. Partly because I have a flight to catch and he has a train to catch.
Okay, so those are the 2 questions.
Yeah. I don't know whether the translation is accurate or complete. There are 2 Chinese translations. One was done in Taiwan and one was done on the mainland, so they're simplified and modern characters. So I need to get a student of mine to go and look. My impression is that the regime is most sensitive about discussion of internal problems. So people who have written books about the Uyghurs or about one-child policy, Western scholars who have tried to do that have had some difficulty. People who write about foreign policy, and maybe particularly people who sort of take China seriously, are more welcome they don't mind if people say they're potentially a challenge or a threat. They seem to be somewhat flattered by that. I was approached at a meeting some years ago by a man who was an academic but at one of the think tanks associated actually with the PLA. He said, well, you know, we know of your work, translated, and so on. I said, that's interesting. You know, what do people say about it? And he said, well, you are not a friend of China. So I subsequently learned that that's a particular category. So I'm in the not a friend of China category, which of course means not a friend of the CCP. But it doesn't seem to influence I haven't found it influence my interactions with Chinese counterparts. I don't go to China that often. I find that Chinese interlocutors are mostly interested in coming to talk when they're concerned about possible forthcoming shifts in U.S. policy towards China. So when they get a sense that there's a debate going on, they kind of want to pulse all positions along the spectrum. They think in terms of factions. So is the pro-China or the anti-China, or however they define it, those up or down, and they want to come and talk about that. What are people saying? Might a new administration change its policy? Is something going to happen? Is U.S. policy going to change over the South China Sea? But that's just a kind of political intelligence collection. It's not important. It's just that they want to know what everybody in the system is saying. I do kind of have the feeling at times, though, that I think of this as it's like the comedian standing up in front of the nightclub and one person is not laughing. And they want to know why you're not laughing. So if you're not really with the program, they want to kind of know why and try to figure out who you are and why you have these unsavory views.
Right.
So,
but at least here, you use the word unsavory. I remember in years past Googling you and seeing the adjective controversial. But as you touched on a little bit earlier, you're now not considered quite so much controversial, simply because, like you said, the terms of the debate have shifted domestically. So that does credit to your, obviously, your scholarship and to the book. So we should end on that note.
And Professor Friedberg kindly accepted that he will sign some books after this event, so feel free. And please join me to thank our